Fuel prices again a headline today, but with a difference. For the first time in 10 days, there has been no hike in prices. In the last 2 weeks, petrol has risen a rupee, 60-70 paise a litre, and diesel has risen over 2 rupees. However, it's uncertain if this trend of the prices not rising will continue, especially since the rupee continues to weaken, making oil imports more expensive. Now, there are lots of arguments which have been made about whether or not the center can actually do anything. There's the entire issue of the deregulation of petrol prices and diesel prices. Our oil companies can well argue that they can't really do anything since this has all been deregulated. The market decides. On the other hand, there's the entire issue of taxation as well, and the fact that oil is governed to such a large extent by various taxes, which we look at very closely. But what exactly did the Prime Minister say as far as the fuel price hike issue was concerned in 2015? Let's listen in.
डीजल के दाम कम हुए कि नहीं हुए? आपके जेब में थोड़ा बहुत पैसा बचने लगा कि नहीं बचने लगा? आपका फायदा हुआ कि नहीं हुआ? अब हमारे विरोधी लोग कहते हैं कि ये तो मोदी नसीब वाला है, इसलिए हुआ है। अब मुझे बताइए, आपको नसीब वाला चाहिए कि कम नसीब चाहिए? अगर नसीब के कारण पेट्रोल के दाम कम होते हैं, अगर नसीब के कारण डीजल के दाम कम होते हैं, अगर नसीब के कारण सामान्य मानवी के जेब के पैसे बच जाते हैं, तो फिर बदनसीब को लाने की जरूरत क्या है मेरे भाइयों?
Well, if the Prime Minister was speaking about good luck then perhaps that has changed quite dramatically now. It's bad luck as far as the prices of fuel in this country are concerned. Now, the Finance Minister, Arun Jaitley, has also spoken about the fuel price hike just about half an hour ago. Let's listen in.
If you look at the domestic economic situation and the global situation, there are virtually no domestic reasons which are attributable to this. The reasons are global. We must bear in mind that in the last few months, dollar has strengthened against almost every currency. As far as other currencies are concerned, the rupee has consistently either strengthened or remained in a range. It has not weakened qua any one of them. In fact, against most of the other currencies in the world, compared to what it was 4 to 5 years ago, the rupee is better off. We are net buyers of oil, and therefore, if by creating shortages, oil price is temporarily raised, that adversely impacts us. That's an external factor. Eventually, the inherent strength of the Indian economy has to play a very important role. And these fluctuations will calm down. As I said, there is no straight line movement of global crude oil prices. They go up, they come down. In April, there was a lot of pressure. In May, there was a lot of pressure. They were going up. In June, they came down. In July, they came down. Then August onwards, there is again a movement. These are not situations which merit knee-jerk and panic reactions. We were rightly criticizing them because in inflation, there is a world of difference between 11% inflation during UPA and a consistent 4% inflation during NDA. And certainly, we would have been failing in our duty if Sushma ji and I, as leaders of opposition, had not criticized that.
So, opposition when it's convenient. Joining us now, Dr. Ila Patnaik, the economist. Thanks, ma'am, very much for being with us. Madan Sabnavis, the chief economist with CARE Ratings, and Lalita Kumara Mangalam still with us. Dr. Patnaik, you know, there is this a news report which bases itself on an RTI reply, which says that India is exporting refined petrol to 15 nations at 34 rupees per litre. Refined diesel is exported to 29 countries at 37 rupees per litre. For people in this country who are paying 80 odd rupees per litre of petrol, this really hurts. Why would this take place when there is such a diametrically different situation in fuel exports?
Yeah, because you don't put taxes on your exports and you don't do that for anything else. If you had quoted the same figure about the jacket you're wearing or the watch if it's made in India, then it would be exactly the same because the taxes are paid by consumers and so you don't put them on exports.
So whichever country all this goes to, that it would presumably be taxed over there.
Over there.
And obviously the rate of taxation would be the issue. Isn't it also equally true that our rates of taxation and the complexity over there actually makes it incredibly complicated and more expensive?
See, we've chosen a rate of taxation. We could have debated it at a time when prices were low as well, and there were some debates. But I don't think that, you know, changing tax rates every day is a good idea. I mean, today, do remember that, you know, it's the emerging economy currencies that are under stress as well, and the rupee, therefore, is under stress as well. What you could easily see happen if we were to say, oh, cut taxes and increase fiscal deficit. So the two are linked. So if we were to do that and macro fundamentals were to change, if we were to increase the current account deficit and the fiscal deficit, tomorrow you could have a crashing rupee, okay, much more. And, you know, that's going to affect the entire economy. And in the inflation today, you're seeing an inflation in oil prices. You could see that in everything else as well.
Okay.
So let's be careful before we say that when prices go up, let's just start quickly meddling with all our tax rates.
Lalitha Kumaramangalam, you would accept though that this is an extremely politically sensitive issue. Not just that, it affects the lives of millions of people. We've spoken about petrol, but if you look at the issue of diesel in the agricultural economy, the pinch is much more. Isn't there something more that the center should do, or perhaps state governments, many of them BJP state governments, to give relief to millions in this country?
Vishnu, it's unfair to make this BJP or otherwise. As the lady has just explained, you can't go around fiddling with taxes when prices are high or raising them when prices are low. These are long-term, you know, levies, etc., of the state. And with regard to the states, many states have already made their the fact very clear that they don't have an option and they cannot lower taxes because they are going through pretty tough financial times. Now, I'm not saying what's wrong or what's right. I'm just placing facts here. Now, I agree that a rise in petrol and diesel prices affects everybody in the country, you, me, every consumer. But at the moment, we all know that the crude oil prices have gone up basically because the dollar is on a bullish run. And there was a time when the price per barrel had dropped a lot, but petrol prices didn't really drop then either. But then, as pointed out, this is not something that we can be playing around with when prices are high or when they are low. Hmm. Both the states and the center have their share of taxes on petrol, and every consumer feels that too much tax is being levied on petrol. Now, insofar as diesel is concerned, I am an environmentalist. I mean, I feel that diesel should be taxed even more. It's one of the most polluting contaminants that the earth has. Yes, we have to develop other fuels like biofuel or electricity or other stuff, but that's an issue for another debate altogether, so I'm not going into that.
Okay.
I think both the finance minister has made it very clear that, you know, eventually prices will stabilize, and as you yourself have said, it hasn't gone up today. I'm not saying it will stabilize right away or that it won't go up again or won't go down on the other hand, but this is a debate that is, you know, it's very complicated. And it's not quite correct to jump to conclusions and say that we must ask the center and the states, regardless of what government is in power in the states,
okay,
to decrease prices immediately,
okay,
because the crude oil price has gone up. Similarly, you know, the converse is equally true.
Yes.
So I think that we need to understand that this is not something that's being shoved onto the people's shoulders, you know, intentionally by any government. And,
but that said, Madan Sabnavis, let me ask you this.
Between states and the center,
sure, ma'am, I'll come back to you in a moment. I want to go across to Madan Sabnavis, Chief Economist at CARE Ratings. Mr. Sabnavis, we have excise duties, we've got a dealer commission, we've got VAT a few days back. All of these taxes in Delhi towards were actually higher than the actual cost of petrol. In a situation like this, isn't there a great deal of inflexibility, certainly at the level of state governments, irrespective of what they are, where, you know, I mean, they just sit back, collect taxes while people continue to suffer. Is there no room for maneuver?
See, if we're looking at it in terms of the state of the central's fiscal as well as the state fiscals, I think there's definitely pressure on them, and that's one of the reasons why neither of the governments want to really lower the duty rates. As you mentioned rightly, if I look at petrol, the duties are slightly over 100% if I combine both the central and state duties. And if you look at diesel, it's around 67%. And quite clearly, on account of this double phenomenon of crude oil prices going up as well as the rupee depreciating, the cost of petrol and diesel are going to go up. Now, the choice is very simple, that in case we let the prices be where they are, it's going to be inflationary. It's going to have an impact on RBI's monetary policy. Interest rates are going to go up, and that's going to affect the economy to the extent that investment could be retarded or industry is going to have another setback. So I think this is the kind of a trade-off which is there, which the government will have to take, because today there are no other choices which you really have. We either compromise somewhere on the fiscal and say, okay, let me have a higher deficit this time, but let's make sure that inflation is under control, because inflation affects everyone. Or alternatively, we can stick to fiscal prudence and then limit higher inflation. So I think it's just a choice which the government has to make. I don't think there's anything right or wrong. It's just a tough call which has to be taken both by the central and the state governments. The center, to my mind, has more flexibility in terms of fiscal deficit, whereas the talk of states, they are constrained by the 3% FRBM norm which is there.
Dr. Patnaik, Dharmendra Pradhan last week had said it was the increasingly isolationist policies of the United States which has at least partly landed us in this price situation. You know, I mean, is this something because of American pressures, because of, you know, is something which where we might see in a finite period of time a further escalation in fuel prices?
See, this repeatedly happens. There are global shocks of various kinds, whether there is tension in the Middle East, whether it is the U.S. policy, whether, you know, the sanctions against Iran. So something or the other comes up. It's not the first time it's happened. I think the good part of what's of today's situation is that after shale oil was discovered, we find that beyond 80 it becomes so profitable that that kind of keeps the price of oil at that level. It doesn't go shooting up to 90 and 100 and 110. So that economy there is actually managed to give us a range-bound oil price.
For now.
For now. But, you know, when, I don't know, when shale gas deposits
and the reason I say for now is because people have been saying, are we going to, at some stage in the not-too-distant future, touch 100 rupees a litre of petrol? I mean, you can't even rule out something like that.
You should not rule out something like that, even if it does happen, if the rupee depreciates. You know how long it took India to move away from the fixed price regime? You know how many TV debates one has been in where they said, oh God, look at the size of petrol subsidies.
And how our oil companies were dying.
Exactly. So let's not give this up very easily.
Would you, sir, actually like to tell us a little bit, Madan Sabnavis, about our oil companies? The fact that companies which were under debt, our companies which were suffering so much because of the subsidies which were part of our system, are now entirely profitable. And this entire argument has turned 360 degrees, that people who are suffering were people who were protected earlier on, just a few years back.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this is entirely a zero-sum game. So earlier we had the OMCs who were making the losses. Today what happens is that OMCs are profitable. They're doing well. They're paying high dividends, which comes back to the government in the form of non-tax revenue. So as I said earlier, I think in this kind of a conundrum which we have, somebody will have to give in. So we will have to have these kind of trade-offs which have to be decided. And I agree, going back to something like subsidies may sound something very odd today. So therefore, we feel everything should go according to what the market dictates. But I think one thought out here is that what the government can really consider, probably not right now because this may not be the time to take it up, is whether at all petrol and diesel should be brought under the GST so that in terms of what rates we have, they become more reasonable and something which is fixed. Yesterday, I think 100% and 67% is just a bit too high for any particular product. And I think as long as we have these kind of high duties, these kind of pressures are going to keep coming every time there's any kind of a problem in the oil world.
All right. Well, one way or the other, one would hope that these prices actually come down. It's gone up now for 10 days consecutively. Just today was some good news. The prices were stable. But I'd like to thank all our panelists very much for joining us.